who you are, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, our Savior and our Redeemer. Holy Spirit, we ask your presence in our midst today to lead us to worship our Lord and Savior the way that we should worship our Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Be with us throughout this service, and we give you the praise. Amen. Hallelujah.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Yes, soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah. That's what we're looking forward to, isn't it? Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. 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 My heart is filled with laughter and my lips with praise. My heart is filled with laughter and my lips with praise. My heart is filled with laughter and my lips with praise. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. The joy of the Lord is my strength. 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 The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Hallelujah. Where our strength comes from,
yes,
isn't it? Hallelujah.
Yes. Praise you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who strikes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my. That you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would. would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Hallelujah. That's the reason we sang to him, isn't it? Yes, hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
You ever feel like you need some rest?
Just thank you, Jesus.
Need to cool it for a while. He tells us what to do, doesn't he?
Thank you,
hallelujah.
Jesus.
He says, come unto him.
Amen.
All ye are heavy laden and burdened.
Come unto me.
He will give us rest. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hear the blessed Savior calling the oppressed. Oh, ye heavy laden, come to me and rest. Come no longer tarry, I your load will bear. Bring me every burden, bring me every care. Come unto me,
and
I will give you rest. Here and there, dragging chains of doubt and loaded down with care. Do unholy feelings struggle in your breast? Bring your case to Jesus, he will give you rest. Come unto me.
Amen.
mountain, dark with sin and shame, stumbling toward the pit of hell's consuming flame. By the power of sin, deluded and oppressed, hear the tender shepherd, come to me and rest. Come unto me, and I will give you rest. Temptation offered conquered men, has a sense of weakness brought distress within. Christ will sanctify you if you claim his best. In the Holy Spirit he will give you rest. Come unto me,
says, come to him, right?
Hallelujah.
If we want the peace that he gives, we have to come to him.
Hallelujah.
The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have,
I need you, and I know I do.
'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you.
Hallelujah.
The only real peace that I have, dear Lord.
Today, Jesus is the answer. It's the Lord. You know, there was a time where I couldn't go to sleep, and I had all these things going round and round in my mind, and the verse came to my mind, you know, cast all your anxieties upon him because he cares for you. And I got out of bed and went into the living room and knelt down, and just all those things that are going round and round in my mind, I just began to give them to the Lord. And the Lord and I were making a trade. Every time I gave him what was troubling me, he had given me peace, and we just kept making a trade, and soon he had all my problems and I had all his peace, and I went back to bed. Praise the Lord. Jesus is the real answer. Amen. Praise God. If you need peace today, we're going to pray. You just cast your anxieties on him. He knows, he cares, and he knows exactly what to do in your situation. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I haven't read through these requests. There's quite a few, but praise the Lord. I'm just going to pray through them. Lord God, we just thank you for your throne of grace. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that, Lord, it's a new and living way that you opened up for us. Lord, we can come confidently because, Jesus, you died for us. Lord, you clothed us in your righteousness. Father, you call us your children. And so, Lord, we're never interrupting you. Lord, we're never, Lord, like as parents sometimes, we're like, well, we don't want my kids to bother me right now. Lord, you're not like that. God, we can come to you. And, Lord, we lift up, God, each and every care, every need. Lord, Judy Carlson, Lord, she has a spot on her lung. God, we pray that you would touch her. Jesus, you are still the balm of Gilead, Lord. God, we lift up Brock Bailey, God, and Lord, you know the healing that he needs. Lord, Boone Lunsford, Lord, has a bad reflux. God, needs your touch. Lord, Chesney, this 13-year-old girl, God, we've been praying for her. Cancer and a stroke. Lord Jesus, you are the Lord of life. You created her for life. God, we pray that, God, that you would intervene, Lord. God, that you would raise her up, Jesus. God, we thank you, God, that you touched that other young girl, Olivia, and she's cancer-free right now. God, Lord, do it for Chesney, Lord. Come through for her, Lord. Give her hope. Give her family faith, Lord. Jesus, you are the Lord of glory. Jesus, touch her, heal her, God. Lord, we lift up Beverly Lunsford. God, she's going to be having surgery next week. God, let your peace that passes all understanding to surround her. Lord, be with her, God. Lord, Jennifer, Lord, is going to be having a port put in on the 26th. And Lord, we pray, God, that you would touch our sister, God. Lord Jesus, you are still the healer today. Lord, you picked up her infirmities. You carried her sorrows by your stripes, Lord. Your word says we're already healed, Lord. You purchased it for us. God, touch Jennifer. Lord, heal her, Father, we pray. God, we pray for, Tracy, Buddy, and Cole, Clay heading to Savannah, Georgia. God, let your angels surround them and be with them. Lord, Pastor Tom Eastley, Lord, he's having heart issues, and doctors are still trying to get that under control. God, give them wisdom, Lord. Visit him in a personal way, Lord, right where he's at, Lord. Let him feel your presence and your touch. Lord, Kim Orman, thank you for all that you've done in her life. And God, continue to heal. Continue to give grace. Touch Fred, Lord. He's had pain this morning. I saw him when he came in. And Lord, bless him and minister to him. God, we pray, Lord, for Haley. And you know her need, God. She's going to be having surgery. It's Faye's niece. And Lord, bless her. And wherever she is at in her relationship with you, God, may she know that, Jesus, she can trust in you. Lord, you are a loving Savior. You're her God. Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, for Bethany Brantley, Lord, sinus infection, God, we pray healing for Bethany. For Valerie Brantley, Lord, she's going to be having chemo. Lord, we pray that, God, that you'll touch her, and God, again, wherever she's at, Lord, bless her. God, minister to her, touch her. God, thank you for the medical community. Thank you for the technology we have. But Lord, more than that, thank you, Jesus, that you are God, and you're still touching, you're still healing, you're still doing the miraculous. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, right now, God, you know, if you've whether you're watching online or you're here today, if you haven't yet, just tell Jesus your need. give it to Him. He wants you to give it to Him. He wants to hear from you. And Lord, we give you our cares. We give you our burdens. Thank you, Lord. You designed church to come, a place where we can come. We can be encouraged. We can be unburdened. God, we can be refreshed. Lord, we can be refilled, Lord, to go out and live like you, God, in this world in a new week. Lord, bless us, fill us, touch us. God, those watching online, may they know, Jesus, you are the true and living God. Lord, bless and touch each and every one. Thank you, God, for being with us today. Thank you for taking our cares. Thank you in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Mission Sunday. We want to pray over our offering. And then I'll bring some announcements to you. And we're going to highlight this Sunday. We have Rosemary Baxter and Brother Harvey and Silas with us today. And they're going to tell us about a program that we're being involved in, and it's going to be great for Lighthouse. Praise God. So let's pray over our offering today. And Lord, we come before you and we thank you, Father, Lord, that you have made missionaries out of all of us, Father, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, for your word that goes forth, Father. Hallelujah. Lord, that we spend our time, Father, preaching and teaching others and children, Father, Lord. We thank you, dear God, today for Lighthouse and the way that we are being used, Father, for you. And we thank you for that opportunity, Lord. Bless this offering, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Yes, soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Hallelujah. I want to go over a couple announcements. We have the missions banquet for Brother Kamal Magala, the Great Commission 316. That's going to be over at the in Paducah this year. I've had one person let me know they're interested in going that has never been. So if you've never been and would like to go, that's going to be on the Tuesday, the 25th of June. Of course, we have next Sunday, which is Father's Day. And all the fathers need to be present. Praise God. So I guess that's it.
All right. Well, thank you, worship team. God is doing good things in Metropolis. Praise the Lord. He's doing good things in Lighthouse. And boy, I was hoping Sharon was going to be here. I heard she had texted Stacy, and God's healed her of a couple of things. Praise the Lord. And a stomach issue, and then, let's see, esophagus something. And all right. Well, praise the Lord. God's still healing today. And Robert and I, Potter Baum, we passed out probably about 500 gospel tracks at the Superman Festival, and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's good to get the word out. We made some good connections, some good conversations. Praise God. And at the beginning of the year, I was seeking the Lord, and I was saying, Lord, show me what you're doing in Metropolis. Show me what you're doing. And the Lord said, I'm doing children's ministry. And then I was reading the parable of the wheat and the tares, or the wheat and the weeds, and the Lord spoke to me through that, and he showed me, you know, every child born into the world is innocent, and every child is planned by God, and God has, you know, a purpose for them on earth, and a plan for them to spend eternity with him, but the devil is working to turn those children into weeds, into tares, and to wreck their lives and to use them to wreck the earth. And the Lord showed me that he's working, and he wants us to work with him to raise these children up to be wheat. Praise the Lord. God has great plans, and we've been working on Zacchaeus' treehouse. And you know, I want to thank you all that has been helping with all the work that we've been doing in the Christian Life Center. Even the Baxters were there helping, moving things and cleaning and been painting. And this afternoon, we're going to be throwing out some more stuff. Woo-hoo! And we're going to be doing some more painting. And if you could be here and help with that, that would be good. But this morning, I've asked Rosemary if she would share. I've known Harvey, and so I didn't know a lot about Rosemary, but we got to talking, and she shared her testimony with me, and it's awesome what God has, the burden that God has put on her heart for children in Metropolis. And it's awesome. God told me what he's doing in Metropolis, and he's brought us together to partner together to do a good work for him. Praise the Lord. And I thought, you know, we're partnering together as a church, and you need to hear Rosemary's testimony and why she is the person she is today, and why she has this burden on her heart for children from Jesus. And so, Rosemary, if you'd come at this time, I asked her to come and share. And then afterwards, I'm going to preach the word. But praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's give her a welcome.
Good morning. I'm not going to promise that I'm going to make it through this without crying, because it just doesn't work that way anymore for me. I always give the testimony that before the Lord, that you could come up and hit me in the head with a ball bat, and just out of pure determination and pride, I would not cry. I just had walked that life and had those footsteps that you were not ever going to see, that you were going to affect me. I had built that wall up, and you just were not going to get to me. And I'm so grateful for the grace of God that he is who he is, and he is a loving father, and he never stops pursuing us. No matter what we've done, where we've been, where we've come from, he is there, and he is calling us home, all of us. And I'm so grateful for that. I know I've got 15 minutes. I got a 4-minute video that I want to show, and I have prayed and prayed that the Lord be magnified and glorified, because I really, truly want you to see him and hear him in everything I say. I want to honor him, because I'm standing here before you today only because of him. Only because of him. I am Rosemary Baxter, born Rosemary McDuffie, right here in Metropolis, Illinois. My mom and dad were James and Esther McDuffie. And I don't know if that generation has gone on that knows them. When I first came back here, there were several people that knew who they were. My mom and dad had 4 children. I have 2 older brothers and an older sister. My dad was a very extremely hard-working man. He worked very, very hard. My father was also a functioning alcoholic. My mom and dad both were illiterate, and my dad never went to school. He never learned to read, never learned to write outside of writing his name. My mom did graduate eighth grade, but her education in today's world was more like a second grade education. She still really, really struggled to read. So for me, a child in school, growing up, I went to Central Elementary School over here, which is no longer here, which kind of makes me really sad. I loved that old building. But school was hard for me. It was difficult for me because when I went home at the end of the day, there was no help. There was no assistance. You either got it when you were in school or either I didn't get it in school. It was very hard, and I actually did not learn to read outside of a few sight words and letter recognition, this type of thing, but I didn't actually learn to read until I got into about seventh grade in the old junior high. I was struggling in school a great deal, and there was a lady, a wonderful lady, and I was kind of a little bit rebellious. I didn't want anyone to know what was going on, so I was one of those girls. And there was a wonderful woman, and I say her name, I'm sure everyone here is going to know her, Miss Catherine Eichols. She came into one of my classes, and she took me out, and I didn't need her help. I don't know what she's doing here with me. I don't need any help from her. But she took me into a class along with some other students and very, very quickly won my heart. She saw through all of that and knew that I needed assistance and I needed help. And she gave me a love for learning. And she helped me. I don't even think they do this anymore, but you used to have to learn the Constitution in order to be able to graduate from seventh grade into the eighth grade. Well, you know, that is definitely an act of God for me that ever happened, okay? So, but I did that through her and through her teaching me. I learned so much from her and the way that she addressed me, the way that she handled me, the way that she taught me. And I could not believe as the years went through with me and I started working with children how much of everything she did I was implementing into what I was teaching with kids. How she did it, the way that it worked, and I'm like, oh! That didn't just work on me, that also works on all these kids. All these kids that are really, you know, hardcore, they don't wanna get it, they don't wanna learn, they're just coming in with their attitudes. But it helped me also to be able to see who they are and to look through their little eyes and through their little hearts and see that there's something there that is causing that reaction that I'm getting from them and knowing that for myself. But God, with me, God has showed me, I was asked to speak about 7 years ago. And when I was pulling everything together, I was like, Lord, what is it that you want me to share? How do I glorify you and let everyone know what you've done? Because my walk is so long. The Lord revealed himself to me as a really young girl at Eastland Baptist Church. I was on a bus riding on Sunday mornings. I would get picked up and I would go. And this is something else that I implemented when I started doing bus ministry is every Saturday morning there would be a guy that would come by the house of my grandparents and have a little brown paper bag with double bubble bubble gum in it. And he was wanting to make sure that we were going to be getting picked up for Sunday school the next day. So every Saturday morning, 9 o'clock like clockwork, I'm sitting on the front porch at my grandparents' house. I'm waiting on that double bubble bubble gum so I can find out that I'm going to get picked up for Sunday school the next day. I'm going to tell you, 20 years later, I used the same concept and filled up an entire bus for kids for God. I'm doing the exact same thing, only with Sour Patch Kids instead of Double Bubble. So at that church, though, I had just started going, but I was sitting in the back of the church, and that day, the Lord let me know that I know that I know in my being that he was real. A little girl that had been through some things. I used to spend my Saturday nights and my Friday nights in the TV room at the Moose Lodge. That's pretty much where my weekends were. While bingo was being played, dancing was going on, my weekends were spent in the TV room at the Moose Lodge. But I would go and I would be looking and I would still be searching and not really know what's happening and what was going on. But that particular Sunday, I can't tell you what the sermon was, but I know that the pastor was up there and I felt a drawing in me to go to the altar. And I went to the altar, and I know that the Lord that day let me know that no matter what, no matter where I was, no matter where I was going, that He was real. And no one from that moment on could ever convince me otherwise. I would like to say that I took every step after that as a young girl and walked and my life was perfect, but it was not. I didn't. Because you want to know what was missing? Discipleship. We can't bring children in or anyone in and let them hear the word and then not follow up. There has to be discipleship. There has to be training. They have to be picked up like a child, and they have to be trained no matter what age they are. Because even though I knew that I knew that I knew that He was real and no one was going to change my mind, I didn't know what to do with that. I still wasn't reading well enough to be able to understand the Bible. I didn't know how to move forward. But I knew that I knew that He was real. And I knew every time I was in trouble, every time that I was in my deepest sin, every single time that there was, who did I call out to first? And He was always there for me. Always. I want to take a couple of seconds, if it's okay, and play this video. And I want to follow up after this. Thank you. nothing wasted. That has been a tagline for my life. Since I truly surrendered to the Lord, you know, I've had people say I fully surrendered or I finally, but we have to truly surrender. You can't partially surrender. Either you surrender your life to the Lord or you don't. You're still teeter-tottering. And this, when I was going through this, and there's so many things up there because it is the walk. Every single thing represented in that video is a miracle and 100% proof of God's provision. When we line our lives up with the Lord and we stay steadfast in Him and we pay attention to what His Word tells us, He provides for His work. If it's His, He provides. And I never lose sight of that. It is His, and He just will never, never not provide. Nothing Wasted was a song. And I want to just really quickly to go over where this was when I was. It's a song by Jason Gray. And where I was when I was going through this, it talks about the hurt that broke your heart and left you trembling in the dark, feeling lost and alone, telling you hope is a lie. But what if every tear you've cried will seed the ground where joy will grow? Nothing wasted in the hands of our Redeemer. Nothing is wasted. No matter where we've gone, no matter what road we've walked down, no matter what our history is, no matter where we were, God can take the good, the bad, the ugly, the disconnected, all of it, and you put it into His hands, and this is the product when you turn it over to Him. He will use every part of your story if you allow Him to. Every part of your story for His glory. What the enemy meant to destroy you, what the enemy meant to take you out, God says no. He says no. Because there's someone out there that has a similar story. There's someone out there that has a like history. There's someone out there that is going to see hope in you, through you, that belongs to Him. There's always going to be a connection, always, that you're going to be able to connect with someone. And that is what all of this is about. When we came back here, my husband and I, we came back. I came back with my heels dug in. I'm like, I'm not going back to Massac County. I'm just being honest and being real. When I left here, I'm not going back to Massac County. I'm not, Lord. We were in Nicaragua for 3 years. We were coming back, thought we were headed to Ducoin because that's where the staple was for our ministry in Nicaragua. And I'm like, I'm not on the interstate. But the Lord knew in my heart, your will be done. And He knew that. And He knew that we would obey. But He also knew and allowed me to just be a spoiled little child for a second and say, Lord, please don't take me back. I don't want to go back. But on the interstate, He literally stopped us with a U-Haul and didn't allow us to go any further. And He brought us here, and He planted us here, and what we've watched Him do through my husband's ministry in the nursing homes, we came back looking to do a community center was what was on my heart the whole time, a community center, to be able to open up a community center, to bring the children of Massac County together, and to work with them and to love on them. But then that didn't happen. We kept looking at buildings, and it didn't happen. Everything happens in God's timing. During COVID, we started doing an outreach ministry called Love Thy Neighbor. So we started going in to the different areas here in town, taking games, taking food, grilling, playing, and getting to know the kids and getting to know the families. We did that in all of the different areas from Joppa to Brookport and everywhere in between. Then I went to work at the library, and I had an avenue there to be able to start doing, working with children. I won't call it children's ministry because that's exactly what it was. So to be able to work with children, and then the after-school program grew out of that. And from that, you know, we started growing kids, had 33 kids in that, and started working with the children with homework and just spending some time with them. The children that were coming through COVID had some social issues because they had, some of them were they just trying to connect and trying to do the work on the computers. It was a difficult time for them. And when they started coming in, we started really realizing that. So we started adapting what we were doing and just really working with the kids and watching them grow, watching them just really start doing better in school, start doing better in activities. And then out of that, we all know the story, so here we are. And when I start looking at how much love you guys have given to us through this, my gratitude, I can't thank you enough for the bus, allowing us to use the bus, and then talking to Pastor Laszlo about this building out here. When we went through this, my very first thought was, I'm taking the summer off. I'm just going to take the summer off. I'm going to bury myself in the Word, and I'm just going to breathe for a second. Well, 6 weeks later, I'm into full-blown getting a summer camp ready, which we now have 60 kids registered for, and we already got the after-school program going. And we already have 25 children registered for the after-school program. So I'm just saying, you know, I can sit back for a second and say, I'm not. And God says, yes, you will. And this is what we're going to do. And this is how we're going to do it. And it's through people like you, through the church, the body of Christ, where the denominational walls do not matter. We are the church. There's one church. We are the church and the hands and feet of Christ. And through that, we're going to see what God's going to do, because we've been preaching it from the top of the mountain to the lowest of the valleys, from the east, the west, the south, and the north, that we are not going to allow the enemy to have our children. We are not. And we are claiming our families for the kingdom of God. So I just thank you guys so much, and I hope I've shared everything you wanted me to share, and I thank you for your time, because this is going to be a great season. Okay. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Y'all probably didn't know that about Rosemary, did you? How God took a uneducated, stubborn, hurting girl and has just made her into a wonderful, fruitful wheat, stalk of wheat. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And it's awesome. Harvey and you, just your whole family, just... we need to always be sold out to the Lord. Amen. However he wants to use us. However he wants to use us. Praise the Lord. And so I'm excited what God has planned. And, you know, it's my heart has always been it's Team Jesus. Amen. It's Team Jesus. And I want to see God move in a wonderful way. Not that anybody be glorified but him. Amen. And not only children but families come to the Lord. And I believe the book. You know, I just believe the book. Everything in the book is for today. We're in the New Testament. Some people say that parts of the New Testament are done away with. Folks, we're in the New Testament. The Old Testament wasn't done away with till the New Testament was here. And the New Testament is not going to be done away with till Jesus. Till Jesus arrives and we're with him in person. Praise the Lord. And so I'm expecting people to get saved, people to get delivered from demonic and sin and saved. Praise the Lord. And we're going to see it. We're going to see it in Metropolis. God is doing a wonderful work. And, you know, he's raised up, I don't know who started first. I think Kelly and with the community prayer meetings and praise the Lord and just everything that God is doing, folks, get ready. Hopefully you are ready. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. It's good to, we're in a, you know, don't believe the news. The devil wants to make you think that we're in a hopeless day and age. It's all going down the toilet. And folks, Jesus is Lord. He's on the move. And good things are coming. Good things already happening. The news just doesn't want to show you. There are revivals and young people getting saved all over our country. And happening in Europe and just wonderful things going on. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Well, this morning I had planned to conclude originally, and I told you I was going to conclude my sermon series that we were in. But then after we passed out all these tracts and inviting people to church, I thought, well, if I preach, whether they come, and some said they're going to come to church and they could watch online and prayerfully, I felt like I needed to change gears, and so I'll end our sermon series next week that we were in. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Let's pray. God, we just thank you. Lord, it's all about you. Lord, one day we're going to be in glory. Lord, and we're going to cast our crowns before you because, Lord, anything we've ever done, Lord, is because of you. All things are from you and through you and to you. Lord, we just get to be a part of what you're doing. Lord, as we yield, as we surrender, as we accept, Lord, your gifts and callings in our lives. But, Lord, it's all about you. And, God, we thank you for that. And, Lord, I thank you for the word, God, that you've given me to preach this morning. And, Lord, I pray that our hearts, God, our ears would be open. And, Jesus, we want to see people like you do. Lord, whatever work you need to do in our hearts and lives, we pray you do it. God, if there's anyone who is here or watching online, and Lord, they have not yet, Lord, come into a relationship with you, God, we pray that that would take place today. We pray this, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. I felt I needed to share this story. God is working in my brother-in-law, Jared. He is working in him, and he's a responsible man. He owns his own business. He's been faithful to my sister and the kids, but he's a proud man. In school, he was a school bully. That's who he was. He's a Harley Davidson guy. All his friends are tough Harley Davidson guys. And a number of years ago, a friend of his called him up and said, "Jared, do you believe in ghosts?" And Jared asked, "Well, why?" And he said, "Well, this would happen." He said, "The other night, I was sound asleep, and all suddenly he has his TV going through his stereo. All suddenly, everything just turns on, boom, blasting." He gets out of bed, runs to his living room, and then the TV channels begin changing. And it stops on a preacher. And the preacher is preaching the gospel. And so he's like, "What in the world?" So he shut it off, went back to bed, got back to sleep. Same thing happened. Boom! Sound system comes on, runs in the living room, TV goes on, it starts flipping through the channels again. On another preacher. And preaching the gospel. And so he told my brother-in-law, he said, "Do you believe in ghosts?" And my brother-in-law didn't know what to say to him. But 3 days later, this guy was dead. He ended up in the hospital. He had spinal meningitis. They couldn't get the fever under control, and it cooked his brain. Folks, that's the love of God. It's the love of God for one person. I believe he sent an angel into that man's house. I mean, this is something you read about in a book or something somebody made up on the internet. It's true. It's my brother-in-law, you know, telling this story. And whether this man gave his life to Jesus or not, I don't know. But God wanted him to hear the good news again, that he could be right with God. He could be forgiven. He could have heaven as his home. Praise the Lord. God loves people. God loves people. I believe the most known verse in the Bible is John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." And the Bible goes on to say, a lot of times we stop at verse 16, but verse 17, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." The Lord came not to tell everybody how bad they are, how wicked they are, but there's a door. Amen? There's a way out. There's a way up. Praise the Lord. You know, when something is emphasized in the Bible three times, it means absolute, okay? So when the angels are crying, "Holy, holy, holy," it means God is absolutely unadulterated, 100% pure, holy. Praise the Lord. That's who God is. He's holy, holy, holy. Conversely, let me tell you that, you know, the Bible says, you know, we need to calculate the number 666. This is what I believe it is. 666, number seven in the Bible is a number of completion. Number six is falling short. The word sin is an archery term. It means to miss the mark. It's falling short. The devil is sin, sin, sin. You cannot get anything good out of the devil. He is 100% unadulterated, filth, wicked garbage. That's who he is. Well, that's not my message this morning. We're going to be in Luke chapter 15, and Jesus tells three stories. And he's telling it because he wants to let us know what his heart is for people. And the title of this morning's message is The Value of One Person. The Value of One Person. Now, this is a familiar, these are familiar stories of Jesus. And so, saints, don't let your mind go on autopilot. Focus in. God has something to teach us this morning. But this is, so Jesus tells three stories. The first story is of a sheep. Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep. Praise the Lord." I tell you that it's in the same way there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Isn't that an awesome thing when one person gives their life to Jesus? One person repents. All the angels, all of heaven is rejoicing. Our loved ones who have gone before, they're whoo-hoo, they're hooping and hollering. Somebody got saved. Praise the Lord. Now, the second story Jesus tells is about a coin that gets lost. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost coin." And Jesus goes on to say, "In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Praise the Lord. And then the third story. They're all similar, but they're all a little different. This third story tells about a young man who purposely runs headlong into sin. And he says, Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons." How many know every kid is different? Right out of the box, they're different. If we would have had Chloe first, she would have been our only child. So they're all different. And so anyway, in Jesus' story, the younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his field to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate.'" Hallelujah. "For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Praise the Lord. Our Lord Jesus told those three stories. He told those three stories. Well, what prompted Jesus to tell those stories? Well, it's in the first two verses of chapter 15. Now, the tax collectors and the sinners were all gathering to hear Jesus. So the outcasts in the community, the ones people gossiped about, the ones people didn't want their kids to hang around with, go over to their house, these were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." That's why Jesus told these three stories. Now, how many know Jesus loved those Pharisees? He loved those Pharisees. He wanted them to grasp the heart of God. And that's what God wants us to grasp this morning. You know, the other Sunday, I erroneously said the word gospel is a Greek word. Okay, it's not a Greek word. And sometimes I need to get back and be reminded, and I always want to make sure I'm preaching accurately. But the word gospel means good message, and it's an English word. But it's a word that's kind of stuck, and it's hung around. And so Bible translators keep putting it in the Bible. So whether it's Greek or English, it's still not the best word to use because we just think gospel, okay? Gospel, it's a church word now. But the word that when you read gospel translated from Greek, it's evangelion. I'm pronouncing that wrong, but it means good news. In fact, the word that we use, evangelist, is the Greek word, and that means to tell the good news. Praise the Lord. So Robert and I, we were out evangelizing, you know, not necessarily, and I wanted to be undercover with this. See, I went into a tent on Friday, and there's a big thing about to start, and people think I'm part of the show, and I'm like, "Hey, did you get one of these yet?" and hand it out about Superman. I'm going undercover, and then so they read a little bit about Superman, and then they get the gospel. Praise the Lord. But we're out sharing the gospel, and so we were evangelizing, spreading the good news. And so whenever you read gospel in your Bible, just think, it's good news, good news. Jesus preached good news. The disciples preached good news. Church, we're to preach good news. Amen, good news. And, you know, I want this to come across right, but folks, we're living in a world that's broken. It's lost. They're hurting. They've been damaged. They are messed over. You know, Jesus said this. The Bible says this: when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. That's the way God views people. That's the way God views people. They're so messed up. And we need to see people as he does. The devil has taken advantage of them, has wreaked havoc in their lives, has messed them up in so many ways. And the church, folks, we got to get over the shock. We got to get over the shock. Jesus didn't go around belittling people, downing people, making fun of people, how they lived, or ostracizing them. And folks, we need to be careful. We don't do that. Otherwise, we're Pharisees. We're just like the Pharisees, and we need to repent. Folks, even when you see on the news someone was brought to justice and they're wicked and they were put to death, we shouldn't rejoice over that. That breaks God's heart. That wasn't his plan for them. Now, I believe in justice, and I believe, folks, I believe in the death penalty. I believe there are just wars. But it still breaks God's heart. You know, even King David, you know what God told him? He loved God, had a heart for God. He wanted to build God a temple. And the prophet, you know, God told him through the prophet, you know, what the plans are good in your heart, but you're a man of bloodshed. And so you're not going to build it. He fought a lot of wars for the Lord. He fought a lot of wars, just wars. But God used a man of peace, Solomon, to build the temple. So, folks, I'm not saying that we ever say sin is fine. We don't agree with sin. But you know what? I expect a fish to swim. I expect a bird to fly. And I expect someone who doesn't know Jesus to sin. Folks, don't be surprised. Jesus said, clean the inside of the cup and the outside will become clean. You know, we can't convince anybody into the kingdom. We can't shame them into the kingdom. We just tell them the good news. Amen. And live the life. Live the life. In fact, the Lord said that people will know we're his disciples, we're his followers, we're his students by our love for one another. Amen. And so I'm not talking about syrupy love that says, oh, we're okay with sin and all this. But folks, you need to be comfortable to sit down with an LGBTQ person. You need to be comfortable to have coffee with a, you know, whether they're a gambler, an adulterer, whatever they might be. Amen. That's Jesus' heart. Amen. And those people were, you know, people outside of God's grace were drawn to Jesus. And Jesus never minced words. He never was easy on the truth. Amen. Praise the Lord. In fact, I think, honestly, I'm talking about all us preachers in America, I think we're all too easy on the truth. Because Jesus said, unless you're willing to give up everything, you know, instead we're like, well, let's get them to say the prayer and then convince them they got to give up everything. And Jesus says, you give up everything before you come to me. That's the right way to do it. Praise the Lord. So the good news is God loves people. He loves us. Jesus came, died in our place, shed his blood that we could be forgiven, rose from the grave on the third day, and that by faith, if we go to him, we can be forgiven. Praise the Lord. We can have a clear conscience to lay our head down on our pillow at night. We can be cleansed, given a new heart, and a new start in life. Praise the Lord. The old is gone, the new has come. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. So what was Jesus wanting to teach the Pharisees by conveying the same lesson in three different ways? Folks, they're not the same. If you just look at them, you think, okay, you know, God loves lost people, and he rejoices when they come. That's the thing they have in common. But see, the first story is about a sheep, and folks, the sheep wandered off. It wandered off. It didn't mean to get lost. The sheep just got distracted. It got distracted. And it ended up separated from the safety of the shepherd and the flock. And the shepherd was so concerned about that one lost sheep that got his eyes off the shepherd and wandered off that he went looking for it. And he was so happy he carried it back home. But, you know, this is kind of like my daughter Olivia. When she was just a little tyke, she loved butterflies. And we had to keep an eye on her. Because, you know, she's just a little thing, and she'd see a butterfly in the yard, and she'd go chasing after it, and she'd be going off into the neighbor's yard, and she'd probably go all the way across town or in a busy street if we didn't keep an eye on her. She got distracted by the butterfly. And, you know, people wander away from the Lord in the same way. They get distracted in life. Church attendance begins to fall off. Their devotional time with Jesus begins to fall off. They end up far away from where they used to be. And they didn't mean to. They just got distracted and they wandered off. Might be a busy college student, maybe a young couple in love, working on building a career, raising a family, maybe people getting heavily involved in a hobby. Hobbies are fine. You know, boy, I could rabbit trail in a good way on that. I believe we're going to have fun in heaven. We might play baseball in heaven, Silas. I believe that. And I got some stories to tell children, to teach them. But God is a God of joy. He's a God of fun. And we're going to have fun in heaven. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. You know what? Let me just, and I know I'm not supposed to rabbit trail here. If you don't believe me, look at animals. All animals play. They play. It's adults when we get all crotchety and crusty that we think you're just supposed to be serious and not laugh, and the children are to be seen and not heard and all this stuff. It's like, no, I believe the Lord played when he was on earth. Praise God. I don't know what he played. If he played tag or some kind of baseball, I don't know what he played, but he played. And maybe when it snowed, he threw a snowball at his disciples. I don't know, but the Lord had fun because that's who he is. Praise God. But so people don't intend to wander away from Jesus. It happens. It happens. But God loves those people, and he wants to go after those people who wandered away. The second story is about a coin that got lost. The coin was lost due to circumstances beyond its control. Folks, a coin don't wander off. A coin doesn't decide to go do something else. It was knocked off the counter. Maybe the lady had a hole in her pocket. Somehow it fell into the dirt. They had dirt floors back then, and it got lost. It got lost in the dirt, but what we need to know is though that coin was lost and though it was all dirtied over, it never lost its value. Folks, lost people never lose their value. They might be incarcerated right now. They might be living in Gaza and took part in October 7th. Folks, they still have value in the eyes of Jesus. The lady who goes off and gives herself to men or men who've gotten involved in all kinds of things and they feel dirty, they feel filthy, they are still of great value to Jesus. They never lost their value. Folks, we live on earth in a place that is very evil. Things happen beyond our control. Parents' divorce shattering a child's world, a child being molested or kidnapped, person being raised in a false religion, sickness, maybe taking the life of a loved one. Stuff happens and it shakes people's world and they just get lost. It shakes them and they're lost. But no matter how lost they are, they never lose value. Folks, God wants us to see people with value, no matter what they've done. And folks, it's hard. There's some people that's like, give them a shortcut to the electric chair. You know what I'm talking about, right? And there's some people that are just so horrible, but you know what, folks? They still have value. Jesus died for every sin on the cross. That's why it was so ugly. That's why it was so shameful and painful. He took it all. Third story is about a young man who willfully turned away. He was raised right. He had a good dad. He had no excuse. But there were some attractions in this world, and he wanted to partake of that. And we've heard of it. Sister or brother, whatever, decided to sow the wild oats. Folks, wild oats will kill you. They will damage you. I don't care what, that's the lie of the devil, no matter how attractive this world is. And you know, the Bible always tells the truth. The Bible says sin is pleasurable. Sin is pleasurable. Boy, if anybody took that sound bite, this pastor's horrible. Sin is pleasurable. It is. The Bible says for a season. It'll ruin your reputation. It'll ruin your health. It'll take your money. It'll shorten your life. It'll steal you of the dreams and desires that are in your heart. You will not accomplish them. They will ruin your life. That's why God hates sin. It will cut you off from the Lord, and it will give you a ticket to hell. That's what sin does. God hates sin. Well, this young man in Jesus' story said, I want to live the high life. And he went off. And he lost all his inheritance. Then he remembered his dad's home. And the story goes, well, maybe Dad won't accept me back as his son, but maybe I can come back as a servant. But the awesome news is that Dad was watching every day for that son that went off, squandered his money on wild living, partying it up. And his son came back. And even before his son could get done saying his practice speech to his dad, you know, I believe that robe was, again, the robe of Jesus' righteousness. Amen. The ring, the ring. You're a part of the family. Sandals on his feet. He can walk clean again. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, people are like that. Though they may be raised right, they may grow up in church. Some of us have children who have decided, well, I know Jesus, I know about the Lord, but I'm going to go off. I'm going to go off. Well, praise the Lord. God is looking for them to return. Amen? He's looking for them to return. You know, so Jesus is underscoring God's incredible love for people, though they've wandered, though they've got lost in the dirt, or though they've rebelliously decided to sow their wild oats. God loves them. God loves people. Praise the Lord. You know, I was thinking about this the other day in my prayer time. The arm of the Lord is not too short to save. Praise the Lord. You know, the arm of the law might be long, right? But the Lord's arm is even longer. Amen. Praise the Lord. He can reach down into the depths of people's lives and wickedness and evil and whatever the devil's doing, the Lord can grab a hold of someone and reach out and get them. I don't know, did anybody see that little girl who got plucked up by the giraffe? Did you see that? So last night, I'm watching, I just was going through the news on my phone, and these parents were, they were in a, the mom was in back of the pickup truck. I don't know, anyway, they're going through this animal park. And she's like, honey, you know, here, feed the giraffe. Well, the giraffe ate the little girl's food out of her hand and then grabbed the girl and whoop, picked her up. And so I'm telling Stacy last night, she's like, well, what happened to the little girl? How can you tell me a story like that? Is the girl okay? I said, I don't know. So I'm sure she's okay. Otherwise, they wouldn't have just posted it. And so Stacy's all upset. And so I quick did a Google search and the girl's fine. But that long neck, that giraffe, you know, better than that giraffe, God can grab a hold of someone and pick them up. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God's arm is not too short to save. And so as I was thinking about that the other day, I write things down, you know, Google Notes. And because three people came to mind from the Word of God of the Holy Spirit, you know, this book is so awesome. This is all we need. This is all we need, all we need. And the Holy Spirit, He always leaves us, you know, God didn't tell us everything that happened in history, but he gave us everything we needed to know. And we'll know everything when we get on the other side, but what we needed to know. And the Holy Spirit has left us some amazing examples in the Bible of unlikely people to be saved. People who you think may have... they don't deserve to be saved. Person that came to mind, I wrote him down, is Manasseh. Manasseh had a wonderful dad. He had a wonderful upbringing, a wonderful testimonies of what God had done in his dad's life. And this evil, wicked superpower that was going and rolling over nations came to Jerusalem, and God just wiped out their army in the middle of the night. Awesome testimonies. Dad passes on and Manasseh becomes the king. You know what he does? He just chucks off the Lord. He begins to get into witchcraft. And what an example we have today. He gets into witchcraft and all this stuff. Even sacrificing his own children to these demonic idols. And gets off into all this junk, leads the whole nation into sin. He's mistreating the people. He's bad. But you know what? God still loved Manasseh. You can read about it in the Bible that what God does is, and I can't remember, I'm just, anyway, you can read about all the details in the Bible, but he ends up being taken captive to another country, and while he's imprisoned, he wises up and he remembers his upbringing and he calls out to the Lord. And you know what God does? God has him released and he comes back and he's king again. That is amazing. Folks, there's many kids today, even kids who were raised in a Christian home, they're getting into all this occult stuff and Wicca and all this junk. And It's just sad. Stacy and I went to Paducah the other week. We ate at Broussard's. You ever eat at Broussard's? It's a good place to eat. And a couple of the waitresses, you can tell, you know, they're into Wicca. And this one girl, all these Wiccan tattoos all over. Folks, I couldn't even pray over my meal. I said, Stacy, you pray. It just broke my heart, and I wanted to tell her about Jesus. And I felt like the Holy Spirit said, no, Brett, just pray for her. Just pray for her. Her name's Belle, B-E-L-L-E. And God didn't want me to say anything at that time, but he said, just pray. You know, I walked into it, ended up going into the crystal shop. This was the other year, and had a good conversation with the owner. She's got a Christian family that tells her about Jesus, and she's so lost. I told her about the Lord. Folks, you go into that crystal shop, boy, you can feel the demonic spirits. I mean, it's thick. It's thick. I don't know if you've ever been there. Go there sometime. The lady's open. Told her about Jesus. But last week we went into this other shop, and this lady had books that are just crazy, and you could tell she's in witchcraft. It's so popular among females nowadays. And on TikTok, it's just exploding. Folks, don't despair. God saved Manasseh. He can save them. Praise the Lord. That's what these testimonies the Holy Spirit has given us. Nebuchadnezzar was a worldly, prideful man. He literally had the world by the tail. He was king of kings. Had everything. Richest, most powerful man on the planet, more than Donald Trump's money. But God knew how to get through to him. We're going to see Nebuchadnezzar in heaven. God knew how to humble that man. My brother-in-law, Jared, he's close. He's close. God just keeps working on him and working on him. He's close. And then we see the example in the Bible of Saul, a misguided religious zealot. Thought he was doing God a favor, but he was working against the kingdom. Saul was a terrorist. He dragged people from their homes, confiscated their property, even had some of them put to death, and he believed he was serving God. He was a terrorist, yet God loved Saul. Praise the Lord, knocked him off his high horse and saved him. Amen? And this man went on to become the Apostle Paul. Isn't that awesome? Folks, don't give up on anybody. The arm of the Lord is not too short to save. Amen? He was able to save a rebellious, backslidden son. He was able to save a proud, worldly man. He was able to save a misguided religious nut. And he's able to save our sons and daughters. He's able to save our lost parents. He's able to save the misguided youth of this country. He's able to save these misguided religious zealots. Amen. Praise the Lord. Through the name of Jesus, he's able to save. No one is beyond the reach of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. So don't let the devil fill you with despair or discouragement about your family or the world. The Lord still saves. Amen. Jesus is the hope for our nation. You know, I see, you know, here, and I'm coming to a close. Yeah, I hear Christians despairing, wringing their hands. Where's the United States in the end times? Where are we going to be at, you know? And I'm like, Jesus is Lord. He's intervened in our country in the past. He can still do it now. There's hope, folks. There's hope. I don't like where our country is heading. I don't like where it's at. I don't like what has happened. But, folks, I have hope, and I have joy and peace in my heart. Jesus is Lord, and he's still saving today. Praise God. Praise God. Well, if I could have the worship team come on back up. And this is what we're going to do. First, we're going to pray. We're going to pray for our lost family members, our lost neighbors. We're going to pray for the lost in Metropolis in Illinois. Praise the Lord. We can even pray for Governor Pritzker. He still has value. Yeah. Amen. We'll pray for Kim. Amen. It's the first thing we'll pray for. We'll pray for Kim. We're going to pray for the lost. And then I'm going to give an invitation for those who may not yet have, that might not yet have Jesus as their Savior, might not have forgiveness of sins, might not yet have heaven as their home. Praise the Lord. Well, let's pray. Let's all stand up. Don't want you to fall asleep. Let's stand up, be alert, watch and pray. Praise God. Amen. Lord, oh Lord, Lord, your love for people is just so amazing. Jesus, you don't cast people off. You don't judge people. Lord, you don't cast them aside. Lord, you created them to be your children. Lord, your heart is that, God, that they turn to you, because Jesus, you bore it all at the cross. Jesus, you bore it all at the cross. And Lord God, anyone who comes to you, Lord, will be cleansed, will be forgiven, and be set free. Thank you, Jesus. We have hope. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, right now, God, before we begin interceding, Lord, for those who don't know you, God, we lift Kim before you. Thank you for Fred. Thank you for Faye. Thank you, Lord. They've been wonderful to Kim. And Lord, no matter how old Kim is, she is still Fred's little girl. And we pray, God, that you'll help Kim right now, whatever's going on with her physically, Lord, that you'll reach down, that you'll touch her, give the medical community wisdom. But Lord, lay your healing touch upon her. Lord, be with Fred and Faye. Give them peace. Bless them. Thank you, Jesus. Send your angels to help, Lord. Thank you for your grace. Thank you, God. And Lord, right now, God, we lift up our family members before you, God. We lift up the people in the community. God, we lift up, Lord, the people in our nation, around the world. God, whether they've been a Manasseh, Lord, whether they've been a Nebuchadnezzar, Lord, whether they've been a Saul, Lord God, whether they wandered away like a sheep or got lost in the dirt, God, whether they have rebelled and just decided to find out what the world is all about, Lord God, your arm is not too short to save. God, your word says that if we pray anything according to your will, it will be done, and your will is that none should perish, but all come to repentance. So God, we thank you that, Lord, as we pray, God, as we pray for family, friends, neighbors, Lord, those we don't even know, God, Lord, we thank you, God, it is your will for them to be saved, and your hearing our prayers now. God, whatever it takes, Lord, we don't want to constrain you. We don't want to confine you in any way. Whatever you need to do in the lives of our families, whatever you need to do, God, in our country, around the world, that people would turn to Jesus. God, that they would forsake their sins. Lord, that they would take you up on your wonderful offer and receive the good news. Whatever you need to do, Father, we pray that you would do it. Jesus, do it. Father, set them free. Lord, the devil is a liar. Jesus, no amount of tarot cards and seances or whatever junk they're involved in can hinder you, Holy Spirit. You are God Almighty. Lord, break through the junk. Break through, Lord. There's so much confusion. Lord, you're not a God of confusion. Lord, break through. Break through. Lord God, let the people, the young people see, God, that it's a deception. It's false. It's empty. Lord, break through and help us, your people. Help us, God, your church, Lord, to love like you. Lord, to treat people. God, Rosemary shared, Lord, how she was loved. She was treated, how she was treated, and it made a difference even to her life today. Lord Jesus, help us, God. Forgive us if we've been Pharisees. Forgive us, Lord, if we've chucked people off or said, well, good thing they're gone or they're heading towards their death. Lord, forgive us, God. That's not your heart. Lord, let us see people, Lord, with value. Let us see them, Lord, with your eyes, Father, just looking for them to return home. Lord, you searching through the wilderness, searching through the woods for that one lost little sheep, Lord, that wandered away. God, give us your heart. Give us your heart, we pray. With every head bowed, if you are away from God today, you need to know that God loves you. He's looking for you. He wants you to be safe under His care, under His protection. He sees you've been kicked around and hurt in this world. Folks, the devil hates you. The devil hates you, and he wants to chew you up and spit you out and ruin every area of your life. It's not God that has brought hurt into your life. You might even blame your parents or circumstances, folks. It's the devil. It's the devil working through things to destroy your life. But you need to know that God's been looking for you. He loves you. And if you're hearing this message, it's His voice. And He's saying, come to Me. Jesus is saying, come to Me. I love you. I'll receive you. Whatever you have done, I paid for it on the cross. Put your faith in Me and I'll take away your sin. I'll make you clean from the inside out. You won't feel dirty anymore. You won't feel abandoned and alone anymore. You'll be safe. You'll be home. You'll be one of Mine. Just turn to Jesus. God's just wanting you to be honest with Him and turn to Him. Receive Him today. Receive Him today. No matter what you've done, maybe you might say, Pastor, if you knew what I did, you wouldn't want to have anything to do with me. Well, you know what? That's not God. God says, I know what you've done, and I still want you. I love you. Give your life to Jesus. Give your life to Jesus. It's never too late until you die. Give your life to Jesus. You know, if you're watching online or you're here today, just give. If you are willing to turn your back on your sin, if you're willing to leave it all behind, just totally leave everything behind, you can be a brand new person today. The Bible says if any person be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. The Lord can give you a brand new start in life right now. Praise the Lord. Just pray this prayer. Just pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I turn my back on my sin. Lord, You know all the things that I have done. God, forgive me for my sins. Jesus, I believe You went to the cross. Lord, You died for me in my place because You love me. Lord, that You rose from the grave on the third day, that I might have life. I believe that, Jesus. Lord, forgive me. Lord, receive me. Lord, I surrender my life to You. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Be my shepherd today. Welcome me home today. Lord, I don't want to be lost in the dirt anymore. Jesus, pick me up. Clean me up. Lord, thank You that I still have worth. Thank You, Lord. And the Bible says that as many as received Jesus, He gave the right, the power to become children of God. The Bible says whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you called on His name today, He's forgiven you. He's received you. It's one thing God cannot do. He cannot lie. Praise the Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. And if you have prayed that prayer and if you've listened to this message earlier, Rosemary was talking about her need to be discipled. Folks, church is an invention by God. It's not perfect a lot of times, but He wants you to be there so you can be discipled. Discipled means to learn Jesus' ways. The devil's still going to lie to you. He's going to still try to sidetrack you. He's still going to try to mess you up. But He wants you to be among a group of believers who've already been through it, who will be there to encourage you, pray for you, help you, and give you understanding on how to walk with Jesus. Amen. Amen. And so if you prayed that prayer online, please phone in or email. And I got some things that would want to get into your hands. Praise the Lord. Maybe you're here today and you gave your life to the Lord. Just raise your hand because I don't want you to leave without getting some things into your hands. Praise You, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank You for our time together today. Thank You, Lord, for the reminder, Lord, of what You've done in one of Your children's life, Lord. Rosemary, Lord, that You're still changing lives. Thank You, Lord, for what You're doing in Metropolis. Lord, we're excited, Father, for the good things you're doing and the plans that are going to be accomplished. Thank you for reminding us, Lord, of how you see people. And Lord, bless us, God, to be like you. Empower us by your Spirit. Keep us close and love people through us throughout this week. God, open up opportunities, Holy Spirit, to tell other people about Jesus. And we thank you for that. Lord, bless your people as we leave today. Amen. Amen. God bless you. And if you're able to come back at 3:00, we're going to continue working on the Christian Life Center so it can be ready to be used for the children's ministries. Amen.